Thank you very much. Now, just so you know, I have made the handout this year just a little different. It's kind of like a little booklet. And I printed enough so that children could also have them and do doodling or drawing pictures as they're sitting there listening. And I learned many, many years ago, let a child be active with something in their hand, and they hear so much more than if you make them sit at rigid attention. So you can draw what you think you hear, or you can draw anything you want, but perhaps the Lord will reach us today in a special way. Well, this is the first of our 2018-19 workshop series, and we're titling it the same as last year, Treasuring God's Design Identity Workshop Series, working on our identity in Christ as the key to happiness and service. And this morning's message is titled, Though I Be Loved the Less. And we're going to be unpacking pretty much 2 Corinthians 2:4 the whole year. I'm going to kind of zero in on one word in the passage. And so, and this morning might be a little bit over, so don't strain. But I have two little videos I'm going to play towards the beginning, middle of it. And that may take up more time than I had hoped for. Then I'll wrap it up afterwards. But as I begin sort of preparing you to catch what's going on, I want to start with the statement. The broken man who is healed by Christ is more beautiful than that man who has never been broken. Adam redeemed is more glorious than Adam in his innocent perfection in the garden. Now that really goes against the grain of our natural instinct. Paul says in Romans 8 that the very reason God allows trials and difficulties into our life is so that we don't become content with a more naturalistic perfection that would satisfy us while we're here and cause us to miss entirely the eternal glory of God, which he has for us. I'm feeling so stupid because I wrote the word down. I told Becky I wasn't even going to share it. Then I shared it with her and started bawling. So I thought, well, guess I'll share it. There's a Japanese art called kintmusi or something like that. And it's an art where they take really, really expensive vessels that get broken, like a flower vessel or something. And of course, Asians are famous for their china. And they take this beautiful, expensive, broken vessel and they put it back together. But the glue they use is the gold. And gold can really be thin, so it can keep the joints tight. And they re-put the vase back together with gold, and the end beauty is greater than the beginning beauty. And that's who we are. That's who God wants us to be. And that's why Paul declared in 2 Corinthians 4, for we have this treasure in earthen vessels. And though it's not there in the passage, the distinction is the broken earthen vessels, the cracked pots, so that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of ourselves. And I know that we go through life wounded in all kinds of ways. Sometimes it's our own fault. Sometimes it's determined unkindness of somebody else against us, like Joseph and his brothers. But nevertheless, we're wounded. And as your wounds and difficulties are healed by the grace of the Lord, the places of your wounding become the places where his glory shines through. And that's what he wants. And put it this way. Let's say we had a before and after picture of you and I. Our before picture is our striving to be perfect in every way that we could be perfect. And then next to the after picture, after we've been totally broken and put back together by Jesus, and his glory creeping through all the broken wounds, everybody is going to fix their eye on the repaired, broken you and utter praise to God. And the perfect you that was never broken will not draw so much as a, oh my, that's pretty good, when compared. Do you think it's a mistake that the scripture says two times, 2 Corinthians and Romans, says that the present distress, present trials, they're not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us? And sometimes the present stress and trials is pretty terrible and horrible, and we can't possibly imagine what glory is going to come out of that. But it will. And the coming comes from just trusting the Lord. But more than that, love lifted me, receiving the love of Christ. So I'm going to ask you, as moms and dads, a question. What does it look like to be a spiritually mature parent? Uh-oh, I shouldn't have asked that question. What does it look like to be a spiritually mature parent? I want to be one. I still have time to grow. So I got myself out of sequence a little bit, forgive me. So I have a verse I'm going to skip for a second and go down to the second verse. This is what it looks like to be a mature servant of the Lord. And I will very gladly spend and be spent for you. Though, or maybe in our modern English, even though, the more abundantly I love you, the less I be loved. But be it so. The hardest part about being a servant of the Lord is to love with that perfect love of Jesus, and to have that very act of love be seen, be interpreted, and be judged and treated as unworthy, as profane, as how could you do such a thing? So the love receiving, and there's probably, you as a parent, you've already probably experienced this probably more than once, where you're pouring out your whole life for your children, for a child, and the more you love them, the less they love you. You're unfair. Everybody else has this. How come you don't love me? And there's the battle, and it's there. But I think the wonderful joy is to realize that's such a privileged place for you and I to walk, because there we get to grow in that presence and purpose of Jesus as his servant in this life. Now the verse I skipped, John 10:10, Jesus says this, the thief comes not but to steal, kill, and destroy. So the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But this is Jesus speaking. But I am come that they might have life, and they might have it more abundantly. And I want us to understand at the outset here the structure of the battle that we have as privileged servants of the Lord, as parents. We have an enemy, and it's the devil. And he's coming like a thief to steal, to kill, and destroy. And so he's very cunning in the mechanism and how he does that. And he's coming for our kids. And that coming for our kids not only is scary in the thought of it, but it's scarier in the act of it, as our kids get taken in some form, captive to that thief who's stealing their hearts, their affections, their understanding, their outlook, who's killing their love for Christ and the things that you raised your children in, and who's just tempting to destroy a life eternally. So that's the battle that'll never not be there. If you don't get rebuked for your real sins, you'll be rebuked for imaginary ones. Now Scripture says it's better to be rebuked for imaginary ones because you have a share of the sufferings of Christ. So that's our goal. Our goal is never to not be rebuked. It's to be rebuked for loving Jesus and trusting Him and serving Him in the midst of a world that has been deceived by Satan. Now, we're focusing, I didn't mean to skip over, but we're going to be focusing on anguish of heart today. And as we go through 2 Corinthians 2, 4, I'm going to take one word at a workshop, and I'm going to run out of workshops, so I don't know either which I'll cram together or which I'll ignore at the end. But this morning, anguish of heart, it comes from 2 Corinthians 4, and I'm going to read the whole passage here to get a little bit of the context. But listen very carefully. Just let me give you just a little bit of a background, okay? The Lord has used 2 Corinthians to heal me more as a parent than any other book in the Bible. And the amazing thing about reading 2 Corinthians is you have to read 1 Corinthians. And so you're going to hear about a letter that he wrote. And I want you to understand that the letter that he wrote was 1 Corinthians. And Paul spent a lot of time there, and at the time he's writing this letter, his name is dung among the Corinthians. He's like, oh brother, that guy Paul, I mean, what a bore. He doesn't have popularity. He's despised. So these two letters are the most crafty letters I've ever read in my life. So full of love, so full of correction and the strongest way possible, but never without the carefulness of true love. And so he's speaking about that desire to come to them in a physical presence. And just so you know a little bit of the background, at the end of 1 Corinthians, he says, I'm going to come to you. Here's my plan. I'm planning on going here, and then I'm going to come to you by Spain because I'd like to have some more input in your life. Well, he never came. He never came when he promised. And so now the Corinthians were holding that against him. You didn't keep your word. Now, if you go back to 1 Corinthians and read it carefully, it absolutely says, in clear writing of Greek, if the Lord will, I'll come to you. But they were offended because he said, I'll come to you. They didn't even bother to comprehend the if the Lord will part. So he's now addressing that just a little bit, but listen carefully. I determined this with myself, that I would not come to you again with heaviness. The heaviness of a parent towards an errant child who needs correction. I didn't want to come to you physically present with heaviness. For if I make you sorry, then who is he that makes me glad? But you, the very same who are made sorry by me. And I wrote this same thing to you, lest when I came I should have sorrow from those I ought to rejoice. Having confidence in all of you, that my joy is the joy of you all. And then the verse that we'll be unpacking, God willing, this year. For out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote unto you with many tears, not that you should be grieved, but that you might know the love which I have more abundantly to you. That you might know the love that I have more abundantly to you. And going back, I capped the verse 15, which is next. And I will gladly be spent for you, though the more abundantly I love you, the less I be loved. So this morning we're just going to package a little bit that picture of anguish of heart. And at this point I have a couple videos to play. So get ready, kids, these are fun. And I'm going to play the videos, make a brief comment, and then wrap up my message. But I've never done this in my life. But I can't believe it. I embedded a video in my slideshow. And I think it's going to work. I hope it works. All right, here we go. Click on the link. Yep. It allows me to click on the link. Where's my glasses?
The Wemmicks were small wooden people. All of the wooden people were carved by a woodworker named Eli. His workshop sat on a hill overlooking their village.
Somebody needs to hit the lights.
Each Wemmick was different. Some had big noses, others had larger eyes, and some were tall and others were short. Some wore hats, others wore coats. But all were made by the same carver, and all lived in the village. All day, every day, the Wemmicks did the same thing. They gave each other stickers. Each Wemmick had a box of golden star stickers and a box of grey dot stickers. Up and down the street, all over the city, people spent their day sticking stars or dots on one another. The pretty ones, those with smooth wood and fine paint, always got stars. But if the wood was rough or the paint chipped, the Wemmicks gave dots. The talented ones got stars too. Some could lift big sticks high above their heads or jump over tall boxes. Still others knew big words or could sing pretty songs. Everyone gave them stars. Some Wemmicks had stars all over them. Every time they got a star, it made them feel so good. It made them want to do something else and get another star. Others, though, could do little. They got dots. Punchinello was one of these. He tried to jump high like the others, but he always fell. And when he fell, the others would gather around him and give him dots. Sometimes when he fell, his wood got scratched, so the people would give him more dots. Then, when he would try to explain why he fell, he would say something silly, and the Wemmicks would give him more dots. After a while, he had so many dots that he didn't want to go outside. He was afraid he would do something dumb, such as forget his hat or step in the water, and then people would give him another dot. In fact, he had so many grey dots that people would come up to him and give him dots for no reason at all. He deserves lots of dots, the people would agree with one another. He's not a good person. After a while, Punchinello believed them. I'm not a good Wemmick, he would say. The few times he went outside, he hung around with other Wemmicks who had lots of dots. He felt better around them. One day, he met a Wemmick who was unlike any he'd ever met. She had no dots or stars. She was just wooden, and her name was Lucia. It wasn't that people didn't try to give her stickers, it's just that the stickers didn't stick. Some of the Wemmicks admired Lucia for having no dots, so they would run up to her and give her a star, but it would fall off. Others would look down on her for having no stars, so they would give her a dot, but it wouldn't stay either. That's the way I want to be, thought Punchinello. I don't want anyone's marks. So he asked the stickerless Wemmick how she did it. It's easy, Lucia replied. Every day I go and see Eli. Eli? Yes, Eli, the woodcarver. I sit in the workshop with him. Why? Why don't you find out yourself? Go up the hill. He's there. And with that, the Wemmick who had no stickers turned and skipped away. But will he want to see me? Punchinello cried out. Lucia didn't hear. So Punchinello went home. He sat near a window and watched the wooden people as they scurried around, giving each other stars and dots. It's not right, in what to do himself, and he decided to go and see Eli. He walked up the narrow path to the top of the hill and stepped into the big shop. His wooden eyes widened at the size of everything. The stool was as tall as he was. He had to stretch on tiptoes to see the top of the workbench. A hammer was as long as his arm. Punchinello swallowed hard. "I'm not staying here." And he turned to leave. And then he heard his name.
"Punchinello?"
The voice was deep and strong. Punchinello stopped.
"Punchinello, how good to see you. Come, and let me have a look at you."
Punchinello turned slowly and looked at the large bearded craftsman.
"You know my name?"
the little Wemmick asked.
"Of course I do. I made you."
Eli stooped down and picked him up and sat him on the bench. The maker spoke thoughtfully as he looked at the grey dots.
"Looks like you have been given some bad marks."
"I didn't mean to, Eli. I really tried hard."
"Oh, you don't have to defend yourself to me, child. I don't care what the other Wemmicks think."
"You don't?"
"No, and you shouldn't either. Who are they to give stars or dots? They're Wemmicks, just like you. What they think doesn't matter. All that matters is what I think. And I think you are pretty special."
Punchinello laughed.
"Me? Special? Why? I can't walk fast. I can't jump. My paint is peeling. What do I matter to you?"
Eli looked at Punchinello, put his hands on those small wooden shoulders, and spoke very slowly.
"Because you're mine. That's why you matter to me."
Punchinello had never had anyone look at him like this, much less his maker. He didn't know what to say.
"Every day I've been hoping you'd come," Eli explained.
"I came because I met someone who had no marks," said Punchinello.
"I know. She told me about you."
"Why don't the stickers stay on her?"
The maker spoke softly.
"Because she has decided that what I think is more important than what they think. The stickers only stick if you let them."
"What?"
"The stickers only stick if they matter to you. The more you trust my love, the less you care about their stickers."
"I'm not sure I understand."
Eli smiled.
"You will, but it will take time. You've got a lot of marks. For now, just come to see me every day, and let me remind you how much I care."
Eli lifted Punchinello off the bench and set him on the ground.
"Remember,"
Eli said as the Wemmick walked out of the door,
"you are special because I made you, and I don't make mistakes."
Punchinello didn't stop, but in his heart he thought, "I think he really means it." And when he did, a dot fell to the ground.
So, I've got to get out of here. Touching, huh? So, I'm not careful, I'm going to be showing another movie. All right. Okay, so that was really good. Romans 12 tells us that as Christians, we're not to think more highly of ourselves than we ought, but to think soberly, according to the measure of the gift of God. That thinking of ourselves more highly is pictured in those dots and stars. And if you are honest with yourself, your life can be told as a story of times where you strived for the stars, maybe got a star and were happy to get a star, or times that you got a dot instead of a star, and you were shamed and embarrassed. But what all mattered was what others were thinking of you. But when we think soberly, we don't think inappropriately negatively. We don't think inappropriately positive. We ask the question, how has God made me? And how do I respond with that? So for the sake of time, I got to keep plowing ahead. But don't lose the picture of the dot and the star race, because that's the race we're in until we find our identity in Christ, in Christ alone. Now, the second little blip here is a brief portion of a message from David Wilkerson. He is now deceased, has the church in Times Square Church, New York. And he's just a few years before he passed away in this clip. You're not going to see a picture of him, but you will see the words on the screen as you listen. You can get the volume turned back up to where you had it before.
There'll be present butts, round butts, and fat butts, buns of steel and squishy tushes, old buns and baby boots. So, I guess.
And I look at the whole religious scene today, and all I see are the inventions and ministries of man and flesh. It's mostly powerless. It has no impact on the world. And I see more of the world coming into the church and impacting the church rather than the church impacting the world. I see the music taking over the house of God. I see entertainment taking over the house of God. An obsession with entertainment in God's house, a hatred of correction and a hatred of reproof. Nobody wants to hear it anymore. Whatever happened to anguish in the house of God? Whatever happened to anguish in the ministry? It's a word you don't hear in this pampered age. You don't hear it. Anguish means extreme pain and distress. The emotion so stirred that it becomes painful, acute, deeply felt inner pain because of conditions about you, in you or around you. Anguish, deep pain, deep sorrow, agony of God's heart. We've held on to our religious rhetoric and our revival talk, but we've become so passive. All true passion is born out of anguish. All true passion for Christ comes out of a baptism of anguish. You search the scripture and you'll find that when God determined to recover a ruined situation, he would share his own anguish for what God saw happening to his church and to his people. And he would find a praying man, and he would take that man and literally baptize him in anguish. You find it in the book of Nehemiah. Jerusalem is in ruins. How is God going to deal with this? How is God going to restore the ruin? Now folks, look at me. Nehemiah was not a preacher. He was a career man. But this was a praying man. And God found a man who would not just have a flash of emotion, not just some great sudden burst of concern and then let it die. He said, no, I broke down and I wept, and I mourned, and I fasted. And then I began to pray night and day. Why didn't these other men, why didn't they have an answer? Why didn't God use them in restoration? Why didn't they have a word? Because there was no sign of anguish. No weeping, not a word of prayer. It's all ruin. Does it matter to you today? Does it matter to you at all that God's spiritual Jerusalem, the church, is now married to the world? That there's such a coldness sweeping the land? Closer than that, does it matter about the Jerusalem that's in our own hearts? The sign of ruin that's slowly draining spiritual power and passion, blind to lukewarmness, blind to the mixture that's creeping in. That's all the devil wants to do, is get the fight out of you and kill it. So you won't labor in prayer anymore. You won't weep before God anymore. You can sit and watch television and your family go to hell. Let me ask you, is what I just said convicted you at all? There's a great difference between anguish and concern. Concern is something that you, the biggest interest in. You take an interest in a project or a cause or a concern or a need. And I'm going to tell you something I've learned over all my years, 50 years of preaching. If it is not born in anguish, if it has not been born by the Holy Spirit, where when you saw and heard of the ruin that drove you to your knees, took you down into a baptism of anguish where you began to pray and seek God. I know now. Oh my God, do I know it. Until I'm in agony. Until I have been anguished over it. And all our projects, all our ministries, everything we do. Where are the Sunday school teachers that weep over kids they know are not hearing and they're going to hell? You see, a true prayer life begins at the place of anguish. You see, if you set your heart to pray, God's going to come and start sharing your heart, His heart with you. Your heart begins to cry out, oh God, your name is being blasphemed. The Holy Spirit's being mocked. The enemy is out trying to destroy the testimony of the Lord's faithfulness, and something has to be done. There's going to be no renewal, no revival, no awakening until we're willing to let Him once again break us. Folks, it's getting late and it's getting serious. Please don't tell me. Don't tell me you're concerned when you're spending hours in front of internet or television. Come on. Lord, there's somebody to get this altar and confess. I am not what I was. I'm not where I'm supposed to be. God, I don't have your heart or your burden. I wanted it easy. Didn't want to be happy. But Lord, true joy comes. True joy comes out of anguish. There's nothing of the flesh will give you joy. I don't care how much money, I don't care what kind of new house there is. Absolutely nothing physical can give you joy. It's only what is accomplished by the Holy Spirit when you obey Him and take on His heart. Build the walls around your family. Build the walls around your own heart. Make you strong and impregnable against the enemy. God, that's what we desire.
Amen. I got it. You can turn the lights back on. I know watching videos isn't anything I've ever done in a message before, but both of those fit together.
Lord.
Give us
your word now. Speak clearly to our hearts.
I'm sorry.
Lord, we need you. We need to hear from heaven, and we're trusting you now in Jesus' name. Amen. First Peter, fourth chapter, First Peter, the fourth chapter.
Apologize. So, this passage that we began with today, at the bottom of the screen there, the verse 4 that I'm focusing on says, "For out of much affliction and anguish of heart I wrote unto you with many tears." Much anguish of heart. The Greek word for anguish, and in the King James, the word anguish translated into from the Hebrew. I was astonished that the most times it was used simply of a mother in labor giving birth. Out of much anguish, the child is born. And of course, we know in Thessalonians, it explains that picture of the Lord coming and the birth pangs that those who are the Lord's are going to suffer in the process of the Lord coming. But as I listened to this message, I was driven to sort of get a hold of, well, what does anguish mean? So I have a brief Bible study on the screen. I'm going to try to go through it meaningfully without taking too much time. But the Greek word there for anguish is sunaxe. But just follow me real quickly as I read these verses and give a quick comment. His fame went through all of Syria, and they brought him to him, all sick people that were taken with. And just for your reference, every time you see the little Greek word letters there, that's that word sunaxe. Those that were sunaxed with divers diseases and torments. And it literally means when you're giving birth, mom has contractions, which is the compressing of the womb where the baby is. And as the womb compresses, pushes on the baby, eventually she literally pushes the baby out. So the anguish is giving birth. And it's a huge picture and illustration. But there's this anguish scene. Notice how many times it's used here with just listen, sick people, divers diseases, torments, those possessed with devils, those who were lunatic, those who had the palsy, and he healed them. And he rose out of the synagogues and entered Simon's house. And Simon's wife's mother was sunaxed, compressed with a great fever, and they besought him for her. And the whole multitude of the country, of the Gadarenes, round about him, besought him to depart, for they were compressed, they were sunaxed with great fear. Now, in the three prior cases, the compression was the difficulty, the trial, the unexplainable circumstance that you were compressed in, not by your will, but definitely you're there, and you have to somehow get through this. But here we see a picture where we can be sunaxed, we can be in anguish because we're hearing the Lord, we're seeing righteousness. We might call it conviction, but it's compressing us. We're hearing something. And there needs to be a birth of response. And then again, I missed a separate on this one, but Jesus said, "Who touched me?" And all denied. Peter said, "Master, the whole throng is compressing on thee." And you say, "Who touched me?" And I just, it's another picture of compression. Everyone around pressing in on Jesus because of their compression. Let me just continue real quickly. Jesus says this now of himself, "I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how I am compressed, how my sunaxed, how I straightened until it be accomplished." And the men that held Jesus mocked him and smote him. And here's that little picture of just Jesus being compressed, being put in a place without control of his own to break out. And here we have in Acts, Stephen's preaching. the gospel and people compressing their ears. They don't want to hear because the message is so compressing to them in terms of that conviction. Verse 5 in Acts 18, when Silas and Timothy came from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit. That's probably the closest direct illustration to the words of Dave Wilkerson. He was pressed in the spirit. He looked around and he saw the need. You know, Jesus told us in Matthew 19, look, the fields are ripened to harvest. Takes that picture. But what are we going to see when we see fields ripen to harvest? We're going to see people in that place of their compression, in that place of the pressure from their rebellion, in that place of concern for themselves but not knowing how to get to the other side. And then, so apropos for us as parents, for the love of Christ compresses us, brings that anguish of soul. When you are loved by Christ, you're filled with his love, that love compresses you for others. You see them in their need. We're not stars or dots. Raising our family isn't about trying to raise the child with the most stars. And yet that's how we do it. We try hard to keep the dots off and have a good number of stars. We got a lot of stars, we feel pretty good. Got a lot of success. And Paul speaks of his own life. I'm compressed between two desires. Having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better, and then the other desire, which I guess I clipped the verse. The other desire is to be with you, which is more needful. Which do you choose? Which do you choose? So I just want to close. I want to end with a thought. When you are afflicted, anyway, doesn't matter, fill in the blank how, you're compressed. If you remember the first verse I read, it was all kinds of things that were compressing people. And I want you to understand something. It's spoken to you in such simple words in Hebrews chapter 12. My brethren, consider the words of the Lord. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. And it's not that same word compressed, but that it's the chastenings that bring that compression. He chastens every son he receives. When you have trouble, you have opportunity. And without that, the compression of that trouble, your attention can't be grabbed. And I just want to encourage you to pause and recognize the great privilege of those times of compression. Your capacity to weep and be concerned for your children is greater than your capacity to weep and pray for anybody else's kids. They're yours. And God is going to bring into your life, into your family, unique opportunities where you're pressed, you're compressed, and you see this child struggling with his identity, with her identity, looking to the world for a measure of validation. You're going to see that. And you're going to try to reach, try to stop, try to prevent. And I just want to remind you that go through the pain, go through the process, go through the tears. So many times, our wounds, especially when we're raising our kids, so many times our wounds can and just simply take us out and say, you know what, I'm tired, I'm finished, I'm not going to do this anymore. So many times our wounds are just so tender to the places where we have been broken, perhaps not yet healed. And we just can't fathom any more time. I don't have another piece of broken shard left to give. And yet, the scripture is warning us, is pleading with us, is encouraging us. This is the love of the Lord. The Lord loves you. They go back to the first illustration. When we get to heaven, we're not going to be a bunch of wimmicks with stars. It's not going to happen. We're going to be a bunch of wimmicks with shards. Shards of brokenness that the Lord Himself has healed and put back together. And the weight and the value is going to so outweigh the pain and the process that He has. So we need the vision of welcoming these things. God bless me, in the early years of my marriage, maybe I was 25, 26, and I was, to use an allegory, I was mourning about the broken pieces of my life. Freshly broken pieces. Pieces that I broke because of my sin. And I was ashamed, and I said to my wife, I don't understand it. How can I, to whom God has so loved and so been kind and so mercifully blessed me, how can I be so careless as to break what He's putting back together without respecting? And the Lord reached my heart through her words. She claims she doesn't remember saying this to me. That's usually what it is when the Holy Spirit's speaking through you. She said, you know, now I'm going to say it in allegory, okay? She didn't literally say it this way. But she said, you know, don't you know you're a Wemmick? And as a Wemmick, you're going to focus on the dots and the stars. But when Jesus brought you into His woodshop, poured out the love and the identity that He has for you, He wasn't looking at the dots and the stars, and He knows you have them, but He just wants you to know the healing of who He is. And basically, what happened to me was three things. I saw that I wasn't being rejected by Jesus because some of those dots that were on me were deserved. It was sin of my own choosing. Perhaps unexcusable sin because of God's kindness. But those dots were there because process was taking place. And somehow the Lord granted me to understand the simple picture from Hebrews 12, whom the Lord loves, He chastens. Every son He receives. And what is chastening from the Lord? Chastening from the Lord is literally those lessons by which we give up our stars and our dots. Maybe I should have said it the other way. Give up our dots and our stars. And we say, I just want to be to the praise of Your glory and grace. And thirdly, I went on from that hour. It was an amazing thing. And God trained my spirit. He trained the love button in my heart. That every time I had a new dot put on me in my worldly environment, I was reminded that God loves me. Every time a new shard broke off of my vessel, I remembered God loves me. And He wants to make me into this incredible vessel, which is the promise of Hebrews 12. If you're exercised, you will become the excellent fruit of righteousness will be visible in you. And righteousness is often expressed by gold, but our broken shards are repaired with the gold of God's healing. And it's more beautiful in the end than in the beginning. Now, when I do these messages year to year, I always take the last set of slides from the last year and start them over, and then I rework them into the new pattern. And when I got to the last slide from last year's workshops, this was it. I couldn't believe it, because Paul is writing a letter, and this whole discussion we're going to be having is this, the power of Paul's love, application of anguish of heart in pen or person. And I gave this old saying from my wife's childhood: say it with flowers, say it with mink, say it with diamonds, but never with ink. And know why people think that's a good model? Don't leave a record, don't leave a written record of the stupid things you've said so somebody can prove your fault, hold you accountable. And I had these verses already written from last year, but I couldn't change them. They're right on target. So I want us to understand something. Our lives are being inscribed on one another. And as we're parents, taking care of our children, let's get a little bigger vision. The problem with the loving, tender heart of motherhood is she loves to preserve her children. She loves to prevent her children from being cracked and broken and scattered into shards. It's that protectiveness, and there's nothing wrong with the big picture desire to protect. It's there by God. But we have to remember that it's through much tribulation that we enter the kingdom of God. Through much tribulation, that's going to be our word for next time. But so God has a purpose, and it's on purpose. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. He's got a chastening plan. So he knows who you are. He brought you to himself because you were broken, because you had a need of being put back together. And he has a plan to put you back together for his glory. So we just need to recognize that as God puts us back together, we become a letter. We become something that's inscribed, and other people can see what God's doing in us, and it can encourage them. And another picture here, this is a tiny little tip on parenting. I just couldn't help but see Paul's words from the verse we already read in this verse here in chapter 10. I do not want to seem that I'm terrifying you with letters, because some say his letters are weighty, but his physical presence is weak, his speech of no account. Paul is very thoughtful. There were times, and discipline is really a time when you break a child. You don't break their spirit, but you break their will. When the Lord chastises us, he breaks us. Breaks us at a place that we need breaking. But Paul, in his spiritual wisdom, was recognizing, I want to rebuke, I want to correct, and I want to do it strongly by letter, which was 1 Corinthians. But when I'm present, I don't want to have to harp on the need for correction. I want that correction having, as it were, already taken place. So I just got the simple understanding that, you know, as a parent or person responsible for bringing correction to people, because that's what God's charged me with, be thoughtful about it and look for the best way that you can bring that correction so that in the whole the relationship is kept to the feeling of that loving environment. One of the things that we did as parents was we recognized it's important to correct a child very privately, not in public among the whole bunch of kids. But just be thoughtful. There are ways of bringing the correction thoughtfully that potentially have a way of bringing correction more powerfully and affecting the sense of love more wonderfully. And then lastly, the last verse here. For though I made you sorry with the letter, I do not repent, though I did repent. For I perceive that the same epistle that made you sorry, though it were but for a season. Just the fragileness. How many times do you, by faith, bring some form of correction as a parent, And then you worry and wonder, oh, maybe I shouldn't have done that. Maybe that was the wrong way. You get anxious. But remember, you'll have less anxiety over time if your goal in any correction is not to make someone sorry, but to help them repent. The feelings of sorrow are necessary. The pain of brokenness is absolutely necessary. But the goal isn't just to have the pain. The goal is to be corrected, is to repent. And that's all we can do. You can never make your child repent, but you can bring loving sorrow that will be a prick and point them to your love. And who knows how many years it might be, and they'll remember that love. And it might turn their heart. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful that our responsibility as parents and others with authority, spiritual authority in people's lives, our responsibility is not to raise children, individuals who need no correction, who be perfect in every way, but it's to learn how to walk in the understanding of your love and the necessity of being broken so that you can put us back together properly for the greater good and the greater glory. Give us humility as people to receive those breakings and correction from your hand that you bring in love to us, so that we ourselves also can be full of joy at the healing. And also, Lord, just fill us with the vision of love so that we understand when we're called to correct in your name that we're breaking, not for the disappointment of getting a dot or the failure to get a star, but for that correction so that the excellency of the power and of the glory is of you and not of men. Ask in Christ's name. Amen. I do apologize for going over and promise I'll not do it again.